Several years ago, Linda and I were invited to have dinner with a big Christian family. We had their son in class, and he invited us to go down to their house in Germantown. And they said, there's a wonderful dinner. And then after dinner, it's a Stone King family. Mr. Stone King said, hey, I'd like to show you my dog. And so we went out, and I got the dog out of the barn, and it's an English retriever dog. I've never seen a dog like this. Kind of looks like a black lab. And he took that dog, we're standing out looking out at the field next to his house, and he has three sticks, kind of like rubberized throwing sticks, and the dog is in perfect heel position sitting next to the master, and he takes the first stick and he shows it to the dog and just whips it out on the field, dog doesn't move. Then he takes another one and he shows it to the dog and whips it out in the field in a different direction, dog doesn't move. Then he picks up the third stick and he whips it out on the field, dog doesn't move. And then he turns around to me, he's all laissez-faire, he has all evening. And he looks at me and he goes, now, you got to understand, Greg, a dog will always go after the last thing it sees. That's what he remembers, and that's what he's going to go for, unless you decide he's going for something else. Which one do you want him to get, one, two, or three? Well, that's a quandary for me, because I'm thinking, okay, if he told me the truth, if Mr. Peter Stoney is telling me the truth, then there's no way I'm picking number three, because the dog's one for number three, because that's the last thing I remember. On the other hand, if Mr. Stone King has set me up for this one, then the dog's probably memorizing order one, two, three, so there's no way of picking number one. So the obvious choice was, have the dog get number two, right? So I said, Mr. Stone King, how about number two? And he did something really weird. He put his hand right over the dog's head, and he pointed like this, and then he gave the command, and the dog takes off, goes to get stick number two, brings it, drops it out of his feet, and he's back in the heel position. And Mr. Stone King, all laissez-faire, looks at me and goes, number one or number three, what do you want next? Oh, no, now another choice. If the order thing is true, one, then three, on the other hand, I now have calls for number one, I'm going for number three, trying to call a bluff, and I told him number three, and he points. Dog takes off, goes, gets number three, brings it back. Well, the story gets a little anticlimactic, right? Because you know that dog's going to get number one. And sure enough, that dog goes out and he gets number one and he comes back and he sits down. And I am just amazed that the dog was able to remember all this stuff. And Mr. Stone King and I are just talking about how he trained his dog to get him to do all this stuff. But I am absolutely amazed at the focus of this dog. And I found myself kind of wishing that the Apostle Peter could have been with me at dinner with the Stone Kings, because as I've been reading through the New Testament, and you know I've told you this before, I love Peter because he's so much like him, you know, intent to do right, but usually messing up. Peter has a focus problem. Peter needs to see this dog focus and do what his master wants him to do. Peter has a focus problem. Let me show you what I mean. Let me demonstrate that I'm not just making this up about focus problem. Probably the most familiar story of Peter, other than his denial after Jesus tells him he's going to deny him. Probably the most famous story of Peter in the New Testament is Peter and the disciples when they're in the boat. Jesus has been preaching all day long, and Jesus tells his disciples, why don't you guys go on ahead? And I'll take care of dismissing the crowd. Wait here, tell you what, Matthew chapter 14. Let me show you this story. This is a real familiar story. Matthew chapter 14 tells the story of Jesus preaching by the side of the lake and dismissing his disciples, and they go on, they get in the boat, and also there's a storm, and Jesus comes walking on the water. You know this story. Matthew chapter 14, let's pick it up at verse 20. 22. Immediately, Jesus made the disciples get into a boat and go ahead of him to the other side while he dismissed the crowd. After he dismissed them, he went up into the hills by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone, but the boat was already a considerable distance from the land, buffeted by the waves, because the wind was against it. During the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went out to them, walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. It's a ghost, they said, and they cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, take courage, it's I, don't be afraid. Lord, if it's you, Peter replied, tell me to come out to you on the water. Come, Jesus said. And Peter got down out of the boat and walked on the water to Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was was afraid and beginning to sink, cried out, "Lord, save me!" Immediately, Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" And when they climbed into the boat, the wind died down. Then those who were in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." Did you see it? It's a focus problem. Peter is out there walking on water for pity's sake in the middle of a storm. I mean, he's doing it. He's focusing on Jesus. When he's focusing on Jesus, everything's good. And then he goes, "Oh my goodness, where am I?" And he starts focusing on his circumstances, the challenges of his life, the fact that he's walking on water, the fact that the wind is blowing, the fact that the waves are breaking over the front of the boat. He starts focusing on the circumstances, and then he starts just saying, he's got a focus problem. If that were the only time Peter did that, you'd say, great, he has a focus problem once. No, he has a focus problem. Let's fast forward. The night that Jesus is betrayed, he's having the Last Supper, what we call the Last Supper, with his disciples. And Jesus just totally blows it out of the water, and he stands up, and the rabbi starts washing the disciples' feet, and he comes to Peter. And Peter says, no. This isn't how I have it pictured. This isn't how I have it dialed in. The reality is there's no way the rabbi washes the disciples' feet. That just doesn't work with the picture I have focused. And Jesus says, Peter, you don't know what you're talking about. You need to refocus and let me do this, because I'm trying to teach you guys a powerful lesson that they're going to be preaching about 2,000 years from now. And Jesus is on something, and Peter is just focused on what he thinks it's supposed to look like. That same night, another focus problem. Jesus then takes his disciples, after Judas has been dismissed to go betray Jesus, Jesus takes his disciples across the Kidron Valley, and when he gets over there and prays with his, well, he prays and his disciples sleep, and Peter really has a focus problem then too. But then the goon squad from the high priest's office shows up, and they start to arrest Jesus, and what's Peter do? He goes, this is not how I'm picturing this. You're supposed to bring in this new kingdom. And he whips out his sword, and he starts to take on the guards, and he cuts off the one guy's ear. Let me show this to you. And go back to the Gospel of John, chapter 18, because Jesus just calls him out on the focus problem there as well. John chapter 18, in verse 10. John 18, verse 10, then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's servant, cutting off his right ear. The servant's name was Malchus. Jesus commanded Peter, put your sword away. Shall I not drink the cup the Father has given me? Peter lost his focus on the mission that Jesus is on. I don't want to be overly critical of Peter any more than I want him to come and preach a sermon about me for being, losing my focus too. But Peter lost his focus, and he shouldn't have. It's just 2 hours or so after Jesus explained what his mission was. Jesus has just explained to the disciples, I have to go to the cross. I have to be betrayed by one of you. I have to go die for the sins of the world. This is the mission the Father has given me. And already, 2 hours later, Peter has lost focus on the mission, and he whips out a sword. He's going to take on the world. He's focusing on his mission instead of on the mission of Jesus. One more time, after he does that, there's another time when Peter loses his focus. It's just an hour or two after that moment. Peter hangs in there longer than almost all the other disciples. Judas is gone, he's a betrayer. 9 of the disciples have abandoned Jesus, but Peter and John are hanging in there. They follow Jesus to the place where the high priest is. They follow Jesus into this night of his mockery of a trial. And Peter is standing at the courtyard, in the courtyard of the high priest, and Jesus is just right 25 yards that direction, being beaten up by the high priest guards as they're just destroying Jesus. And a little girl comes up, a servant girl comes up to Peter and says, hey, aren't you one of Jesus' followers? And he can't focus on the moment of loyalty. He loses focus again. And he focuses more on, oh my goodness, what's a little 13-year-old girl going to do if I say I'm with Jesus? And he loses his focus. And again, Peter denies Jesus 3 times. He's got a focus problem over and over and over again. Well, the night progresses, Jesus goes to the cross, Jesus comes back in the resurrection, Peter sees Jesus, and then a few days later, Peter and the disciples are out on the lake, they're fishing, and Jesus shows up on the beach. You remember this resurrection story for Peter. It's in John chapter 21. Just turn a couple of pages over. John chapter 21. I'm going to show you that the focus priority, even after the cross, hasn't been corrected. In John chapter 21, Peter and the disciples are out fishing. They're not having any luck. And Jesus shows up on the shore and he goes, "Hey guys, throw the nets on the other side of the boat." And they do, and 150 some fish jump into their net. And Peter instantly dives in the water and starts swimming ashore. Just like when he jumped out of the boat, he wants to be with Jesus. His heart's in the right place, but his focus is always in the right place. And then he has this conversation, what we call the restoration of Peter, in John chapter 21. Look at verse 15. "When they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, 'Simon, son of John, do you truly love me more than these?' 'Yes, Lord, you know that I love you.' Jesus said, 'Feed my lambs.' Again, Jesus said, 'Simon, son of John, do you truly love me?' He answered, 'Yes, Lord, you know that I love you.' Jesus said, 'Take care of my sheep.' The third time he said to him, 'Simon, son of John, do you love me?' Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, 'Do you love me?' He said, 'Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you.' Jesus said, 'Feed my sheep. I tell you the truth, when you were younger, you dressed yourselves and you went where you wanted. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will dress you and lead you where you did not want to go.' Jesus said this to indicate the kind of death by which Peter would glorify God. Then he said to him, 'Follow me.' Peter turned and saw that the disciple whom Jesus loved," that's the Apostle John, "was following them. This is the one who leaned back against Jesus at the supper, and it said, 'Lord, who is going to betray you?' When Peter saw him, he asked, 'Lord, what about him?' Jesus answered, 'If I want him to remain alive until I return, what is that to you? You must follow me.'" Do you see it again? It just happened again. Peter is in this moment when Jesus is restoring him. Jesus is confronting him with, "Do you really believe in me or don't you? Where is your faith? Have you put all of it in the are both feet in with me?" And Peter's almost to the point of restoration. What's he do? What about him? Peter looks at another guy. Peter looks at the Apostle John and goes, "What about him?" And Jesus has to say, "Focus, Peter. What I do with him is what I want to do with him. I'm talking about you." And Jesus has to focus him again. And this time, Jesus has to focus him on this one. He has to say, "Look, Peter, you've got to decide for you. Not about what everybody else thinks. Not about what little servant girls think. Not about the circumstances of walking on water. You need to answer this question. Do you love me? And if you do, then you need to follow me." And Jesus dealt with his focus problem. Now here's how I know that Jesus finally dealt with the focus problem of the Apostle Peter. You know what happens 30 or 40 days after this moment? Jesus has gone back up into heaven. He's back with the Father now. And on the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit comes in power. And there's that whole weird thing about speaking in tongues and all that stuff. And it causes this uproar in Jerusalem. And this whole crowd, thousands of people come together. And many of those people who came together were the Jews that 40 days earlier were yelling, "Crucify him, crucify him," and they crucified Jesus. This is a hostile crowd. And this hostile crowd is saying to these Christians who are speaking in different languages, and the hostile crowd is saying, "Well, you guys are a bunch of drunks. You guys, it's 9 in the morning. You guys are drinking already." And Peter is the one that stands up and he goes, no. Let me tell you what happened. And for pages in Acts chapter 2, Peter preaches a very focused sermon. And suddenly Peter has dialed in on following Jesus. And he stands up, not to a 13 or 14-year-old servant girl who is afraid of earlier. He's not bothered by the circumstances of a pretty hostile crowd. Peter stands up and he preaches a sermon and he tells the people, "You guys crucified this Jesus. This is the Jesus. You did this to him." And he focuses and he follows Jesus right through the death and right through the resurrection. And the end result is 3,000 people put their faith in the Lord Jesus at the end of the day, Peter, by the grace of God, finally learned how to focus. He's not worried about his circumstances anymore. He's in a pretty tough circumstance. This crowd that killed Jesus a month earlier could very easily have overpowered Peter. He's not worried about his circumstances anymore. He's not worried about the fact that this didn't fit into his plan. This isn't how he saw it. He finally dialed in on what Jesus saw about him. Jesus, who gave him the name Peter. His name isn't Peter. His name is Simon, son of John. And Jesus, when he met Peter, said, I'm going to call you Peter. That means the rock. And I'm going to build my church on you. And Peter finally dialed in on it and focused it. You know, focus is a tough thing. Sometimes we struggle with focus ourselves, and it's really easy to focus in on our circumstances and look around and say, oh my goodness, look at my circumstances, look at the crisis that's going on in my life. And a crisis is real. It's not made up, it's real. A crisis can start in a doctor's office. A crisis can start in your checkbook. A crisis can start in a relationship that's dissolving. And those are real issues, just like Peter walking on water. The wind was real. The waves were real. His feet touching water as if it was pavement. That was real. Focusing on your circumstances can really mess you up instead of focusing on Jesus taking your brokenness. How about this one? The comparison to others. It is so easy when you're walking through life to look at somebody else's life, to look at somebody else's financial position, to look at somebody else's marriage, to look at somebody else's home, to look at somebody else's, wow, they get it easy, I get all the problems. It's really easy to do that. That's the focus problem Peter had. But when you focus and say, Lord, look, I thought my life was going to go this way. You're asking it to go this way. You're asking it to take a detour I did not expect. But remember what Jesus does when he refocuses Peter. First he establishes, do you love me? Do you love me? If so, follow me. Because I know the path is the right path. I don't know if you guys know Dr. Tony Evans. He's a powerful preacher. Check him out on the internet sometime. Tony Evans from the Urban Alternative. That man can preach. And here's what Tony Evans said about focus. He said, where you set your mind is so important because what you set your mind on will penetrate and dominate all of your thinking. If you belong to Christ, you may feel like the enemy is always there trying to chase you down. But when you set your mind on the things of Christ, you can receive God's word and allow it to act as a two-edged sword in your life. What are you focusing on? You like Peter and me? You focus on your circumstances, the wind and the waves, and the fact that your feet are walking on water. Or do you focus on the fact that the Savior is leading you on that path? You focus on what other people are going to think about you, like a 13-year-old girl saying, oh, are you a Christian? You focus on that, on what they think of you? Do you focus on the fact that Jesus sometimes calls you to a path that, wow, I didn't really see it going this direction. I thought if I followed Jesus, it was going to go that direction. Remember how Jesus restores the focus of Peter. Do you love me enough to trust me? And if so, follow me. After the cross, then what? 30 days later for Peter, he went from a guy who denied Jesus 3 times to a guy who stands up and preaches a sermon with his life. May God add his blessing to the reading and explanation of his word.